script that was shot. And after the first screening, the director's cut for New Line Cinema, they kind of took the liberty to let him know that the film, because of what he was trying to get across and make it more of a saga story, there was a lot more dialogue between the good guys. Liu Kang and Johnny Cage, Sonya, and Raiden. Raiden had a much bigger part. And they just felt it slowed it down. And so I couldn't tell you specifically which scenes, but I know that a huge part of the film that they were in was cut. And I was surprised when I finally saw the final film. It was almost like Shang Tsung showed up about every 5 minutes. And that isn't usually the case with bad guys. It's at least 10 minutes, but it seemed like he was always there. And so it happened by the fact that the film was this big, and then they started cutting so that my scenes started popping up even closer. And I was thankful for that. I didn't mind that. And I think it made for the excitement of what the film was. Certainly the music, the soundtrack, mind-boggling. That really kicked it up. It was a double platinum album. The first time that kind of music was used with martial arts, and I think it really fit. Of course, the one song, you know, the theme song, it's got Mortal Kombat. It's like, I can't ever get that out of my mind. And it's funny when I'm just kind of walking around with people, from a distance, you know, they'll recognize me and they'll say, Mortal. I don't mind it, and I rather enjoy it. It's,
I mean, is that, would you say that that's the role you become most associated with now, or?
It is, especially in that world, in that genre of kids movies, of fantasy movies, certainly becoming much, much bigger with Lord of the Rings and The Hobbit and all that, you know. So Mortal Kombat had that potential to become a mass major franchise in continuing stories like that. But I think that and Rising Sun for older people.
Yes.
Was rather impactful for its time.
All right, so I'm going to do this for you. Do you want to take a couple of minute break?
Oh, that would be cool.
So I'm going to run a commercial or two.
Okay.
I'm going to take a couple of minute break. You don't have to drop off. The commercial is just going to run. We can pretty much see each other, and I got to go to the bathroom.
Okay.
It's the one good thing about not being live TV.
Okay.
Sounds All right, good. So I'm going to run a commercial, guys.
All right.
right, guys. Gonna give him a little bit of a break. Gonna get myself a drink, chase down a Red Bull, and we'll get back to your guys' questions. I would tell you to keep them coming, but man, you guys got me packed up with questions here. So I'm gonna get to everybody's questions, I promise. It's just a matter of getting to each one. So everybody's just gotta chill out and relax. Once again, Kari Tagawa, actor who plays Shang Tsung, live with us, and check him out on Twitter. If you go to Twitter, follow him at CH Tagawa. As many of you out there should follow him. He's not just a great actor. Yeah, as you can see, he's a great, pretty much stand-up guy. The more you follow, the more you'll learn, and the more you'll learn of what's coming for 2013 with the MK community and Mr. Tagawa. Anyway, guys, I am back, and
I'm back.
Mr. Tagawa is back with us as well. I am going to go into. Where am I? I got questions everywhere I look. Where is my list of questions that he had just given me? Okay. We already went into that. We already asked. You know what? I'm going to ask this question because this person has a tendency to be a wise ass, and it's just... and it was intended as a wise-ass question.
Right.
I'm sorry. I asked that one already. The marijuana one.
Uh-oh.
Yeah, I forgot I asked that one already. I'm trying to get to the next. All right. Here we go. DJ El Toro. Mm-hmm. How long? Yeah, this is a guy that I know that's actually head-shaved. How long did it take you to grow out your hair for Shang Tsung? Was it your hair at all?
It was. I started out my career with my hair down to the middle of my back, and I really enjoy long hair. So it's kind of odd being bald at the moment, and my hair does grow rather fast. But from the moment that I had that long hair, and in fact was the role of playing a torturing acupuncturist with David Carradine and Lee Van Cleef. I went to the Last Emperor where they shaved my head except for the portion, and it was that length, a long ponytail, and then they weaved in even more hair into it. It'll take a good year or so to start really, it's starting to get longish. I'm kind of keeping it bald for certain roles, and but my goal is before I die to have my hair back. I really miss that. It's quite an experience for those of us who do like that feel. Yeah, feel much more like a warrior when I have long hair. Although bald monk kind of style is kind of cool.
You know, this is actually. It's grown back now, but I had shaved it down because, unfortunately, during the hurricane, the girl who does my hair pretty much lost her house. So, I was kind of in a predicament, I needed my hair done at the time, and I'm kind of a loyalist where, once you're doing my hair, you're the person that does my hair, that's it, nobody else touches it.
Right.
And I kind of said to myself, how do you ask somebody that just lost their house, oh, by the way, can you do my hair?
Right.
So
right.
I wound up going to some other person, and needless to say, I will not be returning to that other person, and I'm helping her rebuild her house now. Okay, DJ Toro also asked, could you discuss your time on Stargate SG-1? When I rewatched the episode of the series that you were in, I was very excited. Was it a job that you really looked into, or did they contact you?
That was a quick one from them, and I was excited to do it. I'd always been very infatuated with playing Genghis Khan. So those kinds of characters, kind of nomadic, sort of wild warrior kind of characters, very much enjoyed doing. The cast was really cool. It was a little, Canada, and if you watch the series and you can identify, it's shot in Canada. Most of the time, it's drizzling rain, and you can't really see it. It's such drizzle. It's not like, a heavy duty East Coast kind of rain. It's almost misty, and they shoot a lot at night. So when you see the lights of a car come by, then you can see how much it's raining. But it was cold. It was cold. And there's one thing, about those kinds of people, is nomadic people, and the character that I played in that. I had since gone to Kazakhstan and Central Asia. Very warm, warm, wonderful people, and there's also that warrior nature. And it's that character, and what was the feeling about that character is, do not mess with those people. If you do something disrespectful, disgraceful, that's it. You really don't want to hang out too much longer than 5 seconds. And by then it's too late anyway. But there's something because we don't come from that kind of culture, a warrior culture, we don't understand that when law is law in a warrior culture, anything that is broken is it's a big deal. It's a big offense. I mean, you don't get a lawyer and then get off on it. It just and there's some parts of that that I appreciate very much about cultures. Not that I think we need to get ruthless or go back archaic in terms of laws, but I think we're definitely gotten to a point where
We softened.
there's softened so much that the law doesn't mean what it really should. The law should represent something where everybody's watching themselves, so they don't cross that line themselves. And when you have laws, if you're going to have laws, enforce them. If not, call it a free-for-all and save yourself a lot of lawyer bills. I don't know. I don't know how we get from that from Stargate,
Here's another question that, like, since you went in a different direction, his question went into a, I don't know how he did this, but it went from SG1 to, what kind of girls do you like?
Oh, interesting. Well, I have to say, it certainly has been over the many years that I've been a man. Not that I was ever not a man, but
You got to watch out. In the gaming community, we have a couple that used to be men. In fact, there's a big Japanese player. She goes by the name of Keio Police, and she was a big model over in Japan. She just came out, I think, last year, and told everybody, "Yeah, by the way, I was born a man." And I mean, you would see her. There was no way you would be able to tell. And then and this guy's that, in the community that said, "Oh man, I'd hit that, I'd hit that, I'd hit that." And then they said, "Uh-oh, wait, it's not fully changed."
Oh, okay. Well, moving right along, my sense is I've always appreciated taller women, number one. Taller women, I just do, and certainly won't get into any body parts, but certainly I'm more interested in women that have more than average intelligence. I like to have conversations with them. It I'm not much attracted to women that I can't really engage in some kind of conversation, and even attracted even more to women who have a spiritual kind of nature. I'm probably the most un-Hollywood kind of Hollywood guy. like for me, I mean, from, you know, I see it as much as anybody else does from outside. Just the nature of Hollywood is you got to be hanging out with a certain kind of woman who's hot and sexy and looks like a prostitute. I mean, it's just ridiculous, you know, the level at which what we call attractiveness has gotten to. And certainly there's nothing wrong with a sexy looking woman, but, you know, please keep your clothes on or take them off, one way or the other. Just, it's ridiculous some of the styles that it's gotten to. Crazy. But women that are taller, more intelligent than not, more spiritual than not, that's kind of the major criteria.
This one comes from Sub-07. Well, we actually got into that portion. How much about the game series and the character were you aware of before actually playing the Shang Tsung in the movie?
Not very much at all. In fact, earlier I talked about my experience of watching the game with my son, playing the game and getting beat so bad I quit. So that was about the extent of it. You know, a lot of actors delve so deep into something, and there are times that I've done that, but certainly that wasn't true with Mortal Kombat. Especially from the script, understanding that there were more important things I had to focus on. Besides, you would think that knowledge about the game or the characters would make a lot of difference, but I was faced with the fact that very clearly Shang Tsung was not going to be Shang Tsung from the game. The look, first of all, was an old man with a beard and wearing a long black jacket and, you know, looking pretty hip. I liken his character as an actor to build sort of cross between a politician and a vampire. And so it was not going to be Shang Tsung from the game. And so I have to say, I have to take credit for a lot of the creation of who he was in the movie. Yeah, it wasn't so influenced about the game, by the game.
Would you consider doing the voicing for Shang Tsung in the next MK game, the next Mortal Kombat game, if you were approached by NetherRealm Studio?
I would, and there was some rumor that I was approached before to do that. If I was approached, I didn't know about it. I mean, there are times certainly that it doesn't get past the agents, or they just say he's on a movie and he's not available, and they never tell us. So it may have happened. Yeah, I would love to do that. There's something about this franchise, Mortal Kombat, not only because I was in it in the first movie, but with understanding of sort of the global reception of the game. I'm very excited in global concept, and the more that I can be involved on a global level, I am very excited about. So yes, I would. I would very much like to do that, yeah. In fact, at one point, when we shot Mortal Kombat, I think it was Mortal Kombat 3 or 4 that was coming out right after the movie.
Three.
3. That I was offered a voice thing, and the guy didn't look much like Shang Tsung at all. But yeah, we had a deal, and in fact, the Friday before I was to leave on Monday, they canceled the whole trip. And part of our deal was certainly cash, but I had them put into my contract to have 3 arcade games. So I don't know why it didn't happen, but yeah, it almost happened then. I would do that definitely in the future.
Ask your time now. Hey, Cyber Harry Carry, if you're gonna ask me a question to ask, you gotta put it in a coherent language. That's all I ask. But if you rewrite that question and rephrase it, and I'll go back to it. From Sub-Zero Smoke Rye, hello, Mr. Kagawa. I was wondering if you had any knowledge of the proposed script for the third Mortal Kombat film. I had met Lyndon Ashby in 2009, and he spoke to me about the fact that there was one script written for the third film by producer Larry Kasanoff and one of his assistants, but it was never produced. Can you shed any light on this mythical script for the third Mortal Kombat film?
I guess Lyndon had a lot more information and interest at that time than I ever did. And all I can say is that this script that is going to be coming out for the third one is absolutely original, has nothing to do with that, and I don't know what really what happened with it. But the only comment that I would make is it's a weird thing, but I by the time I left that relationship with those producers, I had a very clear idea of who they were and how much I really didn't care for them. I was polite enough, but the last thing, in fact, I said when I was leaving the room in the last time I saw that producer, I said to him, "May you get what you deserve." And it kind of confounded him. He didn't know if that was an insult. It's like, and of course it was an insult. And oddly enough, I think it did occur, the fact that they're not involved now.
Okay. I don't, that's not his name. Never mind, is not his name. But can you ask Mr. Tagawa what he thinks of Bruce Locke's representation of Shang Tsung in the Mortal Kombat Conquest series?
Interesting question, because I never watched it. And at that time, I was holding a bit of a grudge. I didn't want to know that there was a series. Sounds kind of stupid, you know. Really, it's very childish. I recognize that. So I didn't see him. I can't comment on it, but from certain comments that I've heard made about it, there are people who really liked that, you know, liked the actor in that role. In fact, one comment I read was that Bruce was the best Shang Tsung. So I can't really comment on it.
I mean, I'll have to disagree with that, but and that's not my biasness. It's just my, like I said, and it's funny because Rolando and I were talking, I guess about a week ago about you know, the whole portrayal of Shang as a character, and we kind of like, you know, went into this tangent about how everybody automatically assumes that he's this bad character, that, you know, he's bad. I said, but, you know, one of the things that the Mortal Kombat series has never really done is never really given you, like, a true backstory to who he is. He just kind of appears to have this tournament. But, you know, one of the things that, you know, we were talking around in jest, said, you know, oh, what if, you know, Shang Tsung's really not as much as you want to think of him as this bad guy, as much as he is, you know, blinded by, you know, some kind of betrayal or some other aspect in his life that actually pushed him to this level, or, you know, the sad romantic, you know, had a girl dying, tried to fix her. Once he realized, you know, he couldn't fix her, he figured out ways to collect souls, and then wound up becoming consumed with that power. You know, as far as Shang as a character goes, we started to say, like, well, maybe he's not, and especially the way you come off in real life, you kind of make me not, you make me not want him to be a bad guy no more. I'm kind of like, well, he's kind of not, he's misunderstood.
You know, it's interesting you should use that word because I've used that word to describe the character from Rising Sun. You know, he wasn't a bad guy; he was just misunderstood. It's very interesting you should bring it up that way because I have come up with my own backstory about who Shang was, and there are reasons why he had become the way he is portrayed. I can't give you any details about it because it's a possibility that it could be doing that very thing, is creating something around that. You know, I'm real clear too that it's almost like in comic books, you know, where bad guys end up with their own comic. Kind of feel that way about Shang Tsung. I think the Mortal Kombat franchise certainly is strong enough to stand on its own without Shang Tsung. There's so many new characters that have come on since the movie. And there's a whole nother world of Mortal Kombat outside of Shang. And although Shang was iconic and had a great part in the first, I think at least after having watched the animated show, I did watch that.
Okay.
And it was clear that Shang Tsung was defeated, a wimpy guy, and then was banished. And Shao Kahn was now the man. So if we follow that example, there's some exiting of Shang Tsung. I would like to see him exit, but resurrected. With a backstory and into a whole nother world. And so I appreciate your sense that, you know, maybe there's something in there in which there's some good inside of him and some other story can be created. I'm so much about creating stories, man. I spent such a great part of my childhood playing by myself that I ended up with a lot of fantasy in my head, so I never had a lack of creativity, creative ideas, creative stories. Yeah.
I gotta stand corrected. Never mind, when I said never mind, is actually a girl on Facebook's gamer tag. So it actually was never mind.
Oh.
So now I got another question from Skits DB Skits DB.
Okay.
Have you thought about making an appearance at conventions of any sort?
I have, and I have on a limited basis, and certainly I mentioned the Comic-Con in Albuquerque. I'll be showing up in Atlantic City for Martial Arts Expo, Alan Goldberg's annual event, the largest martial arts expo in the United States. I attended one in London when I was shooting 47 Ronin with Keanu Reeves. 2 years ago. The film will come out this Christmas, 47 Ronin, based on a samurai story, fantasy version of it from a graphic novel, special effects, samurai kind of thing, you know, very video gamey kind of movie. And this year I'm planning to do more, and certainly, VXG, the Video X Games in St. Martin with our mutual friend Rolando. I'm very, very much excited about being part of that. I'm making a concerted effort this year to definitely dig into the gaming industry. I think it's something that's not being taken seriously enough. And certainly because it involves kids, I do want to be a good influence for kids to have them know that there are us old folks out here that they care about them and that understand them and have gone through the same situations, still rebellious at my age about simply, you know, being asked to accept bullshit. I'm just not interested in accepting bullshit. And I think too much when I was a teenager, and adults, the only thing that they could say is because I say so, because I have the authority, because I'm an adult and you're not. It was never enough of a reason to accept anything. So I've always questioned things. I think we always need to question things. We need to have answers that make sense to us in our guts, in our souls, in our mind. Otherwise, we're never really going to be happy, my sense of it is. And that's why there's so much sort of addiction escape, because we are not living lives that are full. And I think if we do keep asking, keep questioning, we keep fighting for what we think is right, it's going to feel much better about your life. And I'm feeling pretty good, so I have to say it's worked for me.
I like these sneaky questions.
Yeah.
Cyber Harry Carey. James, my final question. Please ask him if he knows Mark Dacascos, or if he knows who or what actor will play Kenshi in Legacy 2.
I know Mark very well. Not for a very long time, but very well in this sense. Mark is an absolutely exemplary role model of a martial artist. Comes from a martial arts family. His father, a master. He, to me, is very much a master in the making, in his proficiency in the art. Consummate gentleman, always so positive. The guy, he smiles more than me, and he looks like a good guy. Like, he looks like the smile actually fits his face. And I have nothing but total respect for Mark. He is in the Legacy series. He's just an amazing guy. Can't say enough good things about him.
I'm going to ask you the next question, and then I'm going to walk away because my wife enjoys freezing me out of the house while I smoke. Oh. So I'm going to grab a sweatshirt while you answer this question.
Okay.
It's from Dominion Method Gaming, and the question is, Mr. Tagawa, which video game character did you enjoy playing more, Shang or Heihachi from Tekken?
You know, you guys really put me in a hard space to answer that kind of question. It'll be a long one, so James, take your time. First of all, in the life of an actor, the joy is, of course, in acting, and in that, to develop a character is the most creative thing that I've ever encountered in a job, having that much creativity. Now, Shang and Heihachi are really quite different characters, and especially one being Chinese and one being Japanese, very much come from a different place. And although Heihachi is not, you know, impeccably a good guy, there's still very much personality, quality traits that you could say are favorable. Not so much with Shang. Not so much with Shang. And so how to find that within Shang was not something that I searched to do, because the nature of the story was much more cartoony. And for the film, that's the way the director wanted to have him played. And for Tekken, the director very much wanted me to play him more real than not. I think Heihachi by nature was not as cartoony anyway. And did I enjoy creating that character? Yes, the situation was a lot different in terms of producing team and the situation of making the film, which was a little bit harsh. You know, staying at a hotel in a casino was just I'd done that once before in a film called On Top of the World with Tia Carrera and the RoboCop guy, Peter Weller.
Peter Weller.
Yeah. And a few other, yeah, Dennis Hopper was in it. And we made the film inside of a casino. So, you know, he stayed in a hotel room, and every time you go through the casino, you just hear these bells going. I mean, it's just like PTS for a soldier. It just got to be too much. So that was a situation in doing Tekken. We shot in Shreveport, Louisiana, which doesn't have the distinction of much of anything.
No, I've been down there.
Oh, man, it's a strange place. You know, I was raised for a couple of years in Louisiana, and
I used to go to Houma.
Really?
Yeah.
It's there wasn't much that I enjoyed during the making of that film. Ian Anthony Dale, although he was one of the highlights of having worked on that film, that we worked together. His father and son, and then subsequently did an episode in Hawaii 5-0 doing that. I'm sure that before we're done, we'll play a couple more father and son kind of team things. Being Japanese, and as proud as I am of being Japanese, it certainly, I was really looking forward to playing Heihachi and making him different from Shang Tsung. At times, the lines kind of blurred, and Shang definitely bled over into Heihachi. There's talk about a second Tekken, although I understand that a lot of Tekken fans are really disappointed by the feature, and I understand that. You know, it's when you play a game every day and you're really hooked on a game, and you don't have producers who share that kind of love of characters, and they don't study enough about creating those characters, fans can really get let down. And I understood that a lot of Tekken fans were let down by the film. But in either case, Shang has proved to be the most popular and approved of character of the two, and I'm fine with that, and I'm fine with the fact that I'm glad to have been able to play Heihachi. I don't think that I would return in that. I would return as Shang, depending on how it goes. It's
good question. From some Cuban guy, in your opinion, who would win in a fight, Heihachi or Shang Tsung?
Good question. You know, it seems to me Heihachi is really much more of a real fighting kind of guy. And Shang Tsung seems to be certainly more of a sorcerer. So if anything, of the greatest power of what a sorcerer could be and what a human could be are certainly very different. And in that sense, I would have to say Shang. In terms of ultimately winning, but not necessarily because he was such a great fighter, but he had these extra kind of skills as a sorcerer. As a straight-out fighter, if Shang didn't have those powers...
Oh, he's dusted.
Yeah. I think so. I think so. Just kind of arbitrary kind of fantasy stuff, but I think it'd be Heihachi.
Okay, from Shinox. If you really could take someone's soul, whose soul would you take and why?
Interesting, and I do recognize the name Shinox from Twitter. So, greetings. I've seen your name come across the screen there. If I could really take a soul... First of all, just to have the power to be able to do that's kind of hard to conceive of, although I think politicians do that. They get people to believe in something so much that people are willing to give up their souls for it in a certain way. I'd say if I had the power to do it, I think the ones that deserve to have their soul taken and kind of spanked and then redone, or some politicians, and I won't mention any names and or political affiliations, because in the bigger picture, I think that it's a kind of profession that requires a certain amount of straight out lying.
It's a bunch of Shang Tsungs running around.
Yeah. Well, I would even give Shang Tsung a little bit more credit that he somehow has some part of a soul, you know. But you got to be pretty soulless to be taking people's souls, and especially, you know, to get people to believe in you and then just totally let them down. Those kind of people need to have their souls taken, and the people that I see that happening most with is our political system, the politicians. That's just personal note. I can't say exactly who.
All right. K7 asks, when and how did you get involved in martial arts? Also, can you rip a man's heart out while it's still beating?
I don't doubt that I have the potential to do that. I really don't. There are times when I've been upset enough to do it, and I know that I have the physical ability to do that, although that isn't something that's crossed my mind as any kind of reality. I don't have any doubt that in the right moment that any of us couldn't do any number of things that are absolutely destructive like that. My history in martial arts began at 13 when I studied kendo. And kendo, of watching how other martial arts are taught, and certainly they don't like you to get hit when, you know, you're beginning in martial arts, especially at a young age. At 13, when I started kendo, immediately started getting hit. Mm-hmm. And in that sense, I'm a proponent of get to the meat of it and let a person decide. And martial arts, although it's more become a sport now, if I can dare to say that, I don't mean to insult anybody who is practicing martial arts, but for a lot of what I see it to be, and certainly not all, it's become a business, to the point where sometimes I was like in shock, because I hadn't really been to tournaments. I never got into that circuit. But certainly with some of the stuff I saw going on at a tournament that I witnessed last year, it just seemed like a circus. You know, with competition between two kids and adults yelling, get him, you know, take him out, you know, it just seemed like wrestling. And a mentality that I think my martial arts masters that I studied with would roll over in their graves and not stop rolling from the kind of things that I've seen. I'm very much against the hype of martial arts, he said, being from Hollywood, where we made the glorification of some of that stuff. I'm there for another purpose besides just capitalizing on that, the genre. You know, the occupation of what acting is. But certainly, I want to be part of bringing back some of the tradition. Not that I believe that tradition is absolutely the only thing, but I think there needs to be a bit of a balance today. I think we've gotten so far away from the true nature of what martial arts is about. I have to say, it confirms the state of the art today. Why I left when I did, early. Because I knew that it was just going to get into some competitive game and our school can kick your school's ass. And I just was not interested in it becoming part of that kind of energy. And whoever's in it today, and if that's what they're about, that I certainly respect their choice. Every man has to make his own choice. And be accountable for it. So as long as that's the case, you know, everybody has a choice to make, and who am I to really comment on that? But, and I was taught by teachers that had nothing of what it's become in mind. And I do respect them and for the nature of the real true martial artists and the principles, I have to say, is what I'm about.
All right. We got the Carib Video X Games. I am assuming this is Rolando. And he asks, how did the role of Shang compare to other roles you did, such as in License to Kill or Showdown in Little Tokyo?
Hey, Rolando, what's up? And I hope we can meet here fairly soon and come to some agreement. This is kind of interesting, being able to be so personal with someone I'm not talking to, but very much into supporting. I've said that before in this broadcast, but supporting you. I saw a video of Rolando about 2 weeks ago, and just was very impressed in the way he presented himself, a very seemingly respectful and interested in what he's doing for his people and his island. So always about supporting that kind of positivity. How Shang was different from the other kind of movies, the role, certainly he stands out in my mind to have the greatest influence, I think, of all the characters I've played, certainly because of the genre for kids and influencing them at that young age. The thing is, from here, how to really keep building on that, how to take the trust, or if I can say that, it's kind of a big word to put out there, about fans and Shang Tsung. I feel that responsibility, and then like with James, when James was talking about wanting to know more about the backstory, I would like to create that and have it become more essentially a character who truly is about the martial arts and the principles and all those things. So a bad guy who realizes his mistakes and comes back in a sort of resurrected life, coming out of limbo, a choice to either learn his lessons or continue in hell. I would like to create a story about a guy who's come through that and made some new decision choices and come back actually to right his wrongs. Yeah, whereas a guy like Showdown in Tokyo, he ain't coming back.
No, that's a one-way trip for him. All right, Shinnok asks another question. He said, did you ever think that after filming the first Mortal Kombat film that you would still be involved with the Mortal Kombat scene nearly 20 years later?
Never really thought about it, but what I did come across in the experience of afterwards, in realizing the effect that it had on, you know, generations of kids, that I had really hoped that there was something I could stay a part of in order to teach. I'm really a teacher, and I don't think I've ever said that directly in any interview, but I really consider that, especially at this age and the experiences that I've been through, that there's so much to share, and it's something that I am very much going to be involved in 2013. That I didn't consciously know it, but I very consciously hoped for it to be something that important. I'm one of those people who doesn't take his own life very lightly. I'm very committed to always getting better, always knowing more, and so that kind of opportunity, and one of the greatest opportunities about being an actor is being able to affect people, and affect people on a large scale globally. And so that ability to teach has always been a dream. I'm happy to have that opportunity again and again. It depends on the structure of what the opportunity is going to look like for that to happen.
Okay, I got 88 OBS BWiz. Would you consider making an audio book or CD with your breathing techniques for players preparing for tournaments?
Yes, I would, very clearly. And I'm looking into all those different options. Certainly webinars. What a great way to share your teachings, you know, where you can reach millions of people in one download. Audiobooks, webinars, mobile apps. Well, here's a mobile app for you guys, and it's probably going to be my first. Excuse me. This system of breathing that led to a complete physical discipline, a martial discipline, without the fighting, but learning about our bodies, has led to understanding my personal body, not your body, my personal body, but just about bodies in general that have some principles that we haven't really ever considered. When was the last time you'd heard someone say that the most important part of our body is our feet? Yeah, is our feet. So when you ask an athlete, what is the most important physical part that lends to your performance? They would, hands down, my guess, way above 90%, say the core. And so, not an unreasonable answer, and certainly that's kind of the peak of what physical training is right now, is core training. Well, in martial arts, that's the first thing that we learn. They never called it core, but learning how to stand on your feet in a particular stance in order to develop balance, and then learning how to fall without getting hurt, would seem like it could translate the best for football players. How to learn to stand with balance, access your core, and how to fall without getting hurt. And instead, in Western sports, what you do is you pump weights and you learn to run. And so, in what I'm about to teach, will also be, not only for gamers, but for martial artists, for athletes, a whole new study of the body. And it's one of the best things that I got from martial arts, was I got the interest of studying the martial arts perspective of the body. And I don't want to get any religious questions about evolution, but certainly our bodies have the ability to ape animal movements, as martial arts in different animal styles has shown. And I think there's a huge part of our body that suffers from not being able to move that way. And I've found a way to teach that in a system. My first mobile app, and you know, you'll get used to this after hearing me for a while. I'm just an out-of-the-box guy. I'm always looking for that different perspective, a way that, you know, is not common, something that someone hasn't expressed before. The first mobile app will be how to retie your shoes, your Nikes, your Reeboks, your New Balance shoes, in a way to change your balance. You'll actually be walking differently. And that first mobile app will teach why the feet are so important. Think about this, and you probably never heard this anywhere. The mass of your body above your ankle and the way that mass moves depends on how you're standing on your feet. And so when you're told a statement like that that you've never heard before, it's only logical, but if it's so logical, why has not someone said it before? Because we've been so hyped up and misdirected. And for purposes other than really knowledge, that we've just never heard it before. Why should we not have heard that from shoe companies? Because they're concerned with something else. So I'm creating a movement. I'm the point guard of that movement to reconsider our bodies and the way it moves for athletes, for martial artists, for baby boomers like myself who wish to live longer and not, you know, die in pain. So,
a quick, as you say, the baby boomer. How old are you?
I'll be 63 this year. And I was born in 1950. And I was very excited growing up, you know, even at 9 and 10, going, oh, I was born in 1950. That means in the year 2000, I'll be 50 years old. And sure enough, it was that exciting when the year 2000, in fact, it celebrated by my role in Planet of the Apes. So it was a bit of an evolutionary process.
That's right. I forgot you were in Planet of the Apes.
Yeah. Usually apes turn into men, or at least in the theory of evolution. I was a man who turned into an ape, so I devolved.
Devolved. All right. Some guy ate. What is the greatest piece of advice ever given to you in life, and who gave it to you?
Wow.
See, the MK community is very deep.
Very, very. It's really interesting because I've never been asked that question. It seems like I should have. advice. You know, it's very odd, and I say it's odd only because you would think that your father would be that. And my father and I had such a contentious relationship. We didn't get along real well, and there were plenty of reasons for it. It's certainly not his fault. And certainly not my fault, but it was just a matter of circumstances. But the one thing that he said, and it had no sense at the time, nor was it said in a way as to become advice. It was just very clearly about a specific situation in which he was trying to talk to me about driving in Los Angeles. And because his job was a driving job, he had told me this once. He had said, you know, Kerry, you always have to know the alternative routes because of the traffic situation in LA. You always have to have an alternative. And in essence, he was saying, you got to have a plan B, you got to have a plan C. And ultimately, that as a piece of advice has really affected me. And not so consciously, it would, like now I couldn't even just consciously tell you right off the top of my head, but thinking about it, that has affected me deeply throughout my life. That sometimes when we get too focused, you know, and it's a good thing to have goals. It's a good thing, you know, to aspire to things, to dream about things. And also, it can be a bit problematic if the one thing doesn't work out. If the one thing just is not right for that time, it might be right for a later time, so you shouldn't give it up. But timing has a lot to do with things. And so in that way, the idea of having plan B, of plan C, it just means spreading your energy in a direction whereby you don't just single-mindedly, although single-minded focus can be a good thing for certain things. In life, it's good to be single-minded about having more than one choice and really looking in other fields for satisfaction. That's the kind of advice from my dad. Other than that, you know, it's a very odd thing to say, and please do not take this the wrong way. It's kind of like, do not do this at home kind of thing. You can do it at home, but the whole idea is when you hear me say that a lot of what we would consider advice has come from within. It's kind of like your inner teacher. I listen to, it's not me, I know it's not me, so, but it is something inside of me that definitely has taught me a lot. It's kind of an odd thing to try to express to somebody who doesn't believe that there's a possibility that we have a consciousness that we can communicate with. Kind of sounds like you should put me away, or I haven't had my medication today.
No, not really.
Yeah, not for you, James, but
and I think for a lot of people, a lot of people here, you'd be surprised.
No, I believe that. I think people who listen to you definitely come from being slightly, you know, a little more special than the average person. And it takes that kind of creativity. It takes being out of the box. And if that's the majority of your group, I understand that. I'm very much absolutely that. I'm always looking to figure things out. The things I enjoy the most, when people ask me, what are my hobbies? My hobby is discovering new ways to do things that haven't been discovered or used before. Anything to help humanity have a little bit more fun in this thing called life than what we make of it, or what we think we know about it, or how we make assumptions about people or races or anything else. I'm always, if you're out of the box, you don't have time for that kind of petty thinking, because you're looking for the highest possibility of what things could be. And we have, they say our brain 90% subconscious. That's a lot of percentage to think that we aren't using, that's available, you know. So I've always been one to work toward using that. I'm very, very keen on those things unseen. Very much so.
And that was with things unseen from Shinnox again. Carrie, if you could choose any actor to succeed you as Shang Tsung, who would it be and why?
I think it'd probably take about two or three different guys.
Don't say Robert De Niro.
No.
Hey, no, come here, I'll take your fucking soul.
He's an amazing actor. He's one of my favorite actors. Certainly, and before I mention any names, the reason why I say that is, and again, it sounds odd, you know, this is what's so cool about actually being able to speak in this kind of form, because it's all about truth. And so if I tell the truth, unless I preface it, it sounds like talking about myself a little too highly. But in this sense, for a character to play Shang Tsung, for the way that I played it, you would have to have total commitment to something that you don't necessarily believe in. I don't believe in evil. I mean, I know there is evil. I don't believe in it as something to aspire to. I think it happens when there isn't enough good going on. And I don't mean what, you know, goody-goody kind of bullshit, but really what is right. And so not believing in evil, you would have to be able to play it in a way that you do believe it. And then on the other side, you have to have, in not believing it, the hardest part is to play looking like you enjoy it so much. And part of that attitude is about the arrogance of evil. So those kind of traits in actors, to put that kind of different spin on it, I think would take a cross between someone like Edward Norton, part of the American History X,
or
part of that sort of intensity. It would take some part of Anthony Hopkins, you know, in his portrayal in Hannibal Lecter. And the arrogance of evil, that's really what makes you hate the bad guy. He thinks he's so cool, he's so smart. And how to do that convincingly and not be that's what That's a tough one. I couldn't name an actor off the top of my head that has that. And what it really signifies to me, that kind of arrogance, is a power. And so how to be a powerful character who's feeling arrogant about being evil, it's definitely a combination of different actors.
I got one I could throw at you that I think might fit the arrogance.
Who's that?
Christopher Walken.
Interesting. And you know, that's a very interesting choice. I think you're right. And certainly when characters that he's played, one that I can remember very specifically, he said, one of my favorite movies, he said, it was so favorite, why can't you remember? It was Christian Slater,
True Romance,
True
the
Romance.
cantaloupe. That's where I got my cantaloupes from. I did these videos about a bunch of players putting
Yeah.
bounties out on them. I took it from that cantaloupe scene.
Yeah, and Christopher Walken definitely had that edge. I think the one thing about Shang too, and that is different from, let's say, the arrogance of Christopher Walken. Shang had like real man balls. There's just something about Shang in his arrogance and his power that you know he's a man. He's got balls. You know he's. And I don't know. And it's not meant to be an insult, and certainly is not an insult. But I don't really get the balls kind of energy from Christopher Walken. I don't know how to explain that, because he certainly is an intense actor. He's a great actor.
Yeah, he doesn't have the balls. I think he what he possesses is, like he always plays a mob boss. Even though in True Romance, he kind of he presented it as if he had the balls, but then
Yeah.
he's a lot of talk with his backup.
Yeah, exactly. And it's exactly right. And so that's yeah, we'll take him for the arrogance, and we'll save balls for somebody else.
All right, let me get to the next one from Pig the
Okay.
Hut, and it's talk about working with Paul Anderson, director of MK. Which director would you love to work with, and name your five favorite movies?
Is that one question?
He threw all three of those in there. I just read it as a big run-on sentence.
Okay. Paul Anderson, it was his second movie. His first movie was called Shopping, a story, a small independent film of a trend that was happening in England at the time, where teenagers would crash a car into a department store and run in and steal one thing. And it
Wow.
was an interesting premise, you know, for thieves. And the film was done brilliantly. So Mortal Kombat was his second movie. He just turned 28 or 29, English, from London, kind of a geeky guy, and geek, and you know, in a good sense. He was certainly a good guy.
Yeah, we're all geeks, so.
Yeah, exactly. Well, geek in the sense that, at least in the stereotypic geek, he wasn't really a physical kind of guy, but he was highly creative, and you know, not a ballsy kind of guy. He definitely was creative in his head and that kind of thing. So he was that kind of person. Absolutely picked the right DP in John Leonetti. That whole look of Mortal Kombat and the dark and the, you know, that the lighting was great and flames and all of that. Just they were a great team. The brilliance of Paul Anderson was certainly in the music, you know, the soundtrack. First time that kind of music, like I said, was used. Very open guy to hear ideas, and I certainly had a ton of them, because the script could never, it never really described Shang Tsung, but I had a very clear idea who he was. But it was, since it wasn't in the script, I had to do a lot of convincing and talking, and he listened a lot. I think that he tried to make a bigger movie than really what it was, and it was, I think, a thing for a second-time director to really want to be taken seriously as a filmmaker. So he was trying to make a film of Mortal Kombat, like I said, you know, with extra scenes that were probably ended up on the floor, although I can't really say with authority, but that's what the word was, that they had cut down a lot of dialogue between the good guys. And typically that kind of happens with a director who wants to sort of make sure that that work represents something, I don't know, important or serious or something like that. And that wasn't what Mortal Kombat should have been anyway, but that's what he shot. So overall, I had a good experience with him. Had hoped that we were all going, he would direct the second one, and that that we would all return to work together, and that certainly didn't happen. He went on to do Event Horizon, a film called Soldier with Jason Scott Lee, and haven't seen anything from him recently, but he definitely kept going. Yeah. And a director that I would want to work with, although his films, it's kind of interesting, another English director, Christopher Nolan, who did a film called Before American Psycho. He did a film with Christian Bale. Forgot. Small independent film. Memento.
Okay.
And great independent film, just like Paul Anderson did one. And then he went on to get big. And I think in the size of films that he's doing, I'm not so sure of kind of the Batman films, although I do appreciate those films. Inception. That's the kind of film that I would really like to do. I'd like to work with a director that has that kind of mind, which is pretty far out there. And I think he is that kind of director. So he would be one. I forgot the last part of the question. Five
favorite movies.
My favorite. Okay, well, five is good. Certainly The Last Emperor, because it was my first film, and it was Bertolucci in China. It was just mm-hmm. so memorable for that. Showdown Little Tokyo, for the sake that it was my first major studio lead bad guy. And so that was an incredible experience. Certainly The Last Warrior. Johnny Tsunami. Number four, and is all of these could be number one for any different reason, but certainly to play a surfing grandfather, a guy who's always smiling, you know, just very Hawaii kind of guy, local guy. And the last one could be this new film coming out, Little Boy, simply because I had such a major part in it and was a good guy and is part of who I am and those kinds of things. Although I think that now with the beginning of my career, the second half, that will be one of the first films, the one coming out next year. And I think it's the beginning of the second half because I'm going to be playing more teacher roles, older roles. It going into video game sort of format, fantasy.
I'm gonna change this up because I think the way I think I might have read it wrong. I think he was naming your five favorite movies in general, that as far as your favorites, not that you've been in, but like your five movies that you say these are the five movies that I love to watch. I can watch them over and over.
Okay. One is Lawrence of Arabia with Peter O'Toole, and it's probably a little known in this generation. But
I've watched it a lot growing up as a kid.
Yeah. It was absolutely a film that influenced me to become an actor. So that certainly is one. Favorite for different reasons. I have a lot of war movies because I was raised in the military that I watched that really influenced me. One is called The Longest Day. It's about the invasion of Normandy. Great movie. You know what? Let's hold that thought.
Okay.
They'll roll across my mind.
All right. MK Finest asks you. Well, we're gonna hit you up for 2012. What was your favorite movie of 2012, and why?
Oh, interesting. Let me think back on the films of last year. You know, and again, something that I have to kind of roll across my head for a while. But the films, and I know that for a long time, Hollywood was really a letdown for the, you know, good 4 or 5 year period. And last year began a return to good stories and character-driven stories. People, you know, after a while, the flash of the special effects and all that, just, it's enough, you know, and unless you have somebody who can portray a character that you really are interested in, it was getting kind of boring. I have to say, and not many people agree with it, but the Bourne, whatever the last one was.
The Legacy. Ultimate,
was that The Legacy?
The Legacy, yeah.
Yeah, you know, partly for the reason why, the reason being is that he would, you know, the way he played the character versus Matt Damon, and both of them, what I liked about it is they were the most unlikely to play a role like that, you know?
Yeah.
They don't really seem like physical kind of guys, but they pulled it off. I know the stunt, the fight coordinator, and amazing guy, Jeff Imada.
He definitely earned his money.
Yeah, exactly. And amazing, amazing fight stuff. And for that reason, for the underdog part of not expecting the actor, I forgot his name. And I like that actor. He's cool. The one that did Hurt Locker. He was in The Town with Ben Affleck.
Somebody in the stream will mention it in 2 seconds.
Yeah. And so I did like that movie last year. I'm trying to remember what movies came out last
year. Was The Gray last year or no? That was the year before. Mm-hmm. With Liam Neeson.
The what?
The Gray. The one where he gets stuck with the wolves, him and his friends.
Oh, I didn't see that.
He's kind of reproducing Taken in different formats.
Oh,
But The Gray was a really, he's going around kicking everybody's ass, but great twist to the movie. Played a very commanding role. Mm-hmm. I mean, basically, you know, one of those stuck out in the middle of nowhere. You know, and the premise of the story is just the fact of, you know, he knows, you know, he's the survival guy, and, you know, everybody else is pretty much workers, you know, and they're trying to get home, plane crashes, and he's got to get them out of the forest, except they're being hunted by a pack of wolves.
Mm. No, I missed that.
It was I got to say, it was one of those movies that I was like, it's going to be Taken Part 2 before Taken 2 actually came out. And it wound up being surprisingly good.
Huh.
Let me get this question out. Because I rarely have this guest that's in the room attend my show. A Mr. Perfect legend, one of the top MK players out there, asks, how does it feel to have defined a character and breathe life into the character's personality?
It was very rewarding. And I haven't had a character in which I haven't experienced that. I have to say, I just have that kind of personality where it's impossible for me to do anything than total commitment. And I have to say, in my career, there isn't a character that I played that I haven't been satisfied with the fact that I gave it my all to create him. And the trick being, too, is to have it be distinctive enough to be very differentiated from another character. Let's say the playboy from Rising Sun is nothing like the character from Showdown Little Tokyo, nor is he like Shang Tsung, nor is he like Johnny Tsunami. Each one of my characters are very uniquely different, and I have never regretted it's so weird to talk about yourself. The quality of the performance was, I didn't feel like I could have added anything to it after having seen it, because I'm that committed when I do it. So, good question. And glad to meet you here in this arena. I know we've talked on Twitter a bit, and it seems your reputation precedes you after having met you on Twitter, and I've heard, you know, good things about you in your gaming, and you're quite a character study.
Yeah, so perfect legend. Don't think I only talk bad about you.
Yeah, no. It's absolutely good, you know. Well, one thing that I'm very clear about, it's coming to the time when there needs to be a real movie about gamers, and especially with this transition that's going on right now and the competition and soon to be gambling, a Vegas style gambling on gamers. It's just like, whoa, this thing is blowing way.
Soon the Yakuza is going to start taking bets.
I'm telling you, we have Showdown in Vegas or something.
Showdown in St. Martin. All right. I got Ashnar down in Florida asks, if you have any meditation techniques you would be willing to share, and if he has written or is going to write a book.
Yes, I'm going to write a book, and I don't mind sharing some meditation techniques. I would rather than share the technique immediately is to just give you a little background and what I think of meditation. Actually, the word, and I'm very keen on words and the use of words, to meditate, you've also heard the phrase to meditate on. So, in essence, the word means focusing. And when we talk about this meditation on its own as a word, it sounds very clearly like an exercise and focusing, but focusing on what? And ultimately, meditation is designed to eliminate thinking or thoughts, which to some people just sounds absurd. But in the realm of meditating, how to get to a point where your mind takes a break, where for 15 minutes, 20 minutes, you allow your mind to reach a state of calm and peace where it's not so confusingly bombarded by the use of your brain. Excuse me. And how to start to feel what it's like not to be working so hard to figure everything out all the time. Very important process. I've been through many different kinds of meditation techniques, but ultimately that seems to be the goal, is how to experience a part of yourself that is not run by the mind.
Okay. Although, let me quickly interrupt on you, because I'm going to have to go on another commercial break, because I'm going to have to go to the bathroom again.
Okay.
Shinox asks, when everything's said and done, What do you want to be remembered for? And I'll, and with that, I will let you answer this. I can step away. They're listening.
Okay. Well, I believe that what I would most like to be remembered for is something that I'm just beginning. In the second half of my career, to be able to play roles that are different than my first half. I think I've played enough bad guys in a way that people, and it's kind of a testament to, I guess, the nature, the quality of me playing bad guys, that when people say, or people are asked, you know, Kerry Hiroyuki Tagawa, and don't recognize the name, the guy from that movie, oh yeah, I remember him, and you know, so it basically says that the energy of the characters that I play, played, that people remember my energy more than my name, and certainly it's changing little by little, that people recognizing my name more and more, just because I'm getting older, and I think more people see my name enough, but you know, I think most actors would be happy that with the kind of work that I've done over the period of time that I have, that in and of itself would be memorable enough to feel satisfied. And to me, it's absolutely not. I feel like the second half is beginning, certainly being able to produce more of my own product, webisodes, doing stuff on a much grander global scale, in a much quicker delivery. That my film presence or webisode presence, just my visual presence and presentation of it, very much looking forward to creating a different view of it. And certainly the biggest part of changing characters, I'm not so interested in playing good guy. To me, most good guy roles are pretty boring. Pretty snoozy ass kind of roles. We know that he's going to beat the bad guy. We know he's going to get the girl. You know, there's just so much given stuff. And how good is a guy if a bad guy, like, kills one of his family, and then the good guy goes on a spree of killing 50, 60 bad guys? It starts to glorify just the killing part and not so much that he's good, but we associate goodness with how many people he kills. It doesn't make much sense, although I'm guilty of being part of that genre of having pumped it. But I have to say, I've done stuff that isn't necessarily me. I believe I've done it well enough, at least to be noticed. But from here on out, just want to get involved in a whole nother round of characters and acting. But what I do want to be remembered most is the healing part, and that's about to begin. So not a whole lot that I can talk about success in that realm. But to have been able to been in Hollywood, to use the notoriety to present Breathing to you, much easier to present something having been a celebrity. So I want to use a celebrity to do that. That is the part, the healing is what I want to be remembered most for.
Okay. Now with the role that you just mentioned,